Okay, we'd like to continue the union special session on the great 11 March 2011 Tohoku earthquake. The first lecture is an invited talk, Strong Motion Characteristics of the 2011 Tohoku Oki Earthquake Observed by KNET and KIKNET. Dr. Aoi and colleagues, Dr. Aoi will present the talk.
Thank you, Chairman. How can I use the arrows to go forward? Okay. In my talk, I will introduce the recorded strong motion data during the Tohoku earthquake, and I also review several related research. Tohoku earthquake was the largest earthquake occurred in and around Japan since the recorded history. 20,000 people were killed or missing, and 300,000 buildings or houses were totally or partially destroyed. Most of the damage was due to the tsunami. This was also the first earthquake, M9 class earthquake, that were closely recorded by the TENS observation network. And ground motion was successfully recorded at more than 1,200 stations. The largest PGA was about 3G, three times gravity, observed at Tsukidate, KNET Tsukidate station. And PGA exceeded gravity at 20 stations, and those stations are distributed in about 300 kilometer wide region. And Sakai reported that the damage ratio directly related to the shaking was not high, even at the large PGA area. Light map shows the PGV, and compared to the high large PGA value, the PGV was not very large. PGV exceeded 100 centimeters per second only at the KNET and Tsukidate station, which is where the largest PGA was observed. Modified mercury intensity was calculated using observed PGA and PGV by the method proposed by WALD. And modified mercury intensity exceeded 10 at only a few stations. Area with MMI larger than 6 is very large, including most part of the Kanto and Tohoku district. And left map is again MMI, and right is population density. And the largest city in the Tohoku district is Sendai, populated about 1 million. 1 million. And several relatively large cities with 300,000 people are in Tohoku, but more people are, of course, live in Kanto area, including metropolitan Tokyo and Yokohama and Kawasaki. The exposed population obtained by summing up the estimated exposed population for 500 meter square is plotted here. Oh, excuse me. And the population exposed to the larger intensity than 7.5 is about 5 million people. And the region where the intensity larger than 5.5 is extended to Kanto area, so the exposed population is very large, about 30,000 people. And next, we consider why the only the PGAs were large. And this triangular shows the major volcano, and this pink line shows the volcanic front. And volcanic front is a low Q zone, and it is well known that when the seismic wave propagates through the this zone, the amplitude drastically reduced. So it is natural that the PGA at the region in back arc is small. So hereafter we consider only the four arc stations. And these two maps show the empirical amplification factor for period range 0.1 to 0.5 and 1 to 2 second. And the empirical amplification factor is defined by average of log observation divided by attenuation relation for many earthquakes. This is essentially the site collection factor for attenuation relation. As you can see, PGA has much better correlation with empirical amplification factor for shorter period here, 0.1 to 0.5, rather than a longer period, 1 to 2 seconds. And for example, here is a large PGA area. The amplification factor for shorter period is large, but the longer period is not large. And the situation is similar for this region. And next, I plot all the stations, four arc stations in this chart. A horizontal axis is PGA and vertical PGV. And the gray line shows the equivalent dominant frequency defined by PGA divided by 2 pi PGV. And as you can see, for all the stations where the PGA were larger than gravity, the equivalent dominant frequency is larger than 2 hertz, which is rather large, high frequency. And this is the same figure, but colored by amplification factor for 0.1 to 0.5 second. The amplification factor for large PGA station is high. Although, for the amplification factor for period range for 1 to 2 seconds is not the case. So the reason why only the PGA large is the only high frequency components were amplified by in a superficial layer. And next question is why damage ratio and directly related to the strong motion was low. This pink rectangular shows the area where the PGA larger than 800 gal and PGV larger than 100 centimeters per second, which is proposed by Kawase as the threshold of the heavy damage for low-rise building, including wooden house. And except for Tsukidate, no other stations satisfied this threshold. Comparing to the disastrous earthquake such as 1995 Hyogoken Namba earthquake or for 2004 Chuet earthquake, the characteristics of the ground motion for Tohoku-oki earthquake is completely different. And PGV is not large enough to be disastrous ground motion. And this is almost the same meaning that the ground motion is high frequency dominant. And this is the acceleration response spectra for most stations where the JMA intensity exceeded 6 minus, corresponding to MMI 8. And Sakai systematically analyzed the response spectra and reported that for those stations, the high large power is exists only for the shorter period than 0.5 second. For the power power is much less than this part for 1 to 2 seconds, which is necessary for damaging low-rise building. And comparing to the disastrous waveform from Takatori in 1995 Kobe earthquake, the power for 1 to 1.5 is much smaller for Tohoku-oki earthquake. Next, I'll introduce the attenuation relation. This black circle shows the observed PG and PGV versus distance from the fault. And the solid red line is the Japanese standard attenuation relation proposed by Shi and Minarikawa. And for most distance range, this relation overestimated. And they compare with this data to the magnitude 8.3 Tokachi-oki earthquake. As you can see, the correspondence is very good. This means that the characteristics of attenuation are very similar, even though the magnitude for these two earthquake is completely different. And this result implied the existence of the saturation of the attenuation relation. This is the record section of acceleration and velocity, ordered by latitude from north to south. And as you can see, the duration of the waveform is very long. It's reached to several minutes. And there are three or even more distinct phases observed. First, strong phases originated near the hypocenter. It's difficult to see here. And subsequent phases also originated at near the same location as the first phases, and is uniformly delayed by about 40 seconds. And third phases are clearly observed for southern part after 50 or 60 seconds after the first phases, and propagated from offshore Fukushima Prefecture. We call these three phases group one, group two, group three. And this is a typical observed waveform in Miyagi Prefecture. This is from Oshika Station, and this is the acceleration. There exist two distinct wave packets, and the time difference is about 40 seconds. And right-hand side, I show the velocity waveform which is obtained by integrating acceleration without any filter. And the short period waveforms are superposed upon long period waveforms. Though the timing of the arrival for short period and long period is not exactly the same, long period waves precede short period. And next, I'll explain about liquefactions. And Kanto area is about 300 or 400 kilometers away from the epicenter. So the damage from the due to the shaking itself is not so heavy. However, the damage due to the liquefaction was severe. The small red circle in left map shows the distribution of liquefaction. As you can see, the liquefaction occurs heavily populated place. And this is Tokyo Bay, and this is lower and middle reaches of Tone River, and this is Kinugawa and Kokaigawa. And liquefaction in the Tokyo Bay occurs mainly at the artificial reclaimed land. And the area of the liquefaction reached to 42 square kilometers, which is one of the largest scale ever observed. And in this area, many high-rise buildings, including high-rise residents, exist, and so many people had a hard time several days after the earthquake. This is the example of sand boil into the road, and this is the damage of manhole. This is the example for Tone River, and Tone River is this, and this Tone River is the largest river in Japan, and through from west to east, and many wooden houses leaned, and telephone pole caved in two. And also the sand boil occurred in rice field. And cyclic mobility was clearly observed. I show you an example from Kenneth Inage. And this is the observed waveform, and this is the zoom up for this red part. You can clearly see the cyclic mobility here. And these are the slip models inverted from inverted using the strong motion data. And the target period is have variety, but typically 10 to 100 seconds. And all models, one large slip is estimated, one or two large slip is estimated for far off the coast. And for Koketsu and others are estimated a little bit near, large slip near to the coast compared to the last model. And there still exists a big discussion how far the slip are from the coast, because the resolution of the slip far off the coast is limited. And this is strong motion generation area for large frequency estimated by forward modeling using empirical Green's function method. And all models, two SMGAs exist near the hypocenter, and two or three SMGA exist near the coast in south area. And as an example, I introduce one slip model inverted by Suzuki et al. They use 36 strong motion data for 8 to 100 second period. And they estimated a large sleep area with a maximum sleep of 48 meters from the area near the hypocenter toward the shallow part far off the coast of the Iwate, Miyagi, and Fukushima prefecture. And these are the CMT solution for interpret aftershocks. Interpret aftershocks are widely distributed from off Iwate to off Chiba, but not occur near the large slip area. And this is a comparison between the slip distribution derived from long period and SMGA derived from short period. And Kurahashi et al. Put two SMGAs near the epicenter to explain the group A and B phases I show in paste up and near the another two asperities in near coast south area to explain group three phase and other phases. And the fact that the location of slip distribution and SMGA is not the same implies the frequency dependency of the seismic wave radiation from the fault. During the earthquake, the data management center in Tsukuba is also suffered by the large ground motion and also the power failure. So we have many difficulty to continue the observation, but I should skip this, excuse me. Several observatories were swept by tsunami. And this is a summary. Tohoku-Oki earthquake was the first M9 earthquake closely recorded by a dense network. And strong motion were recorded at more than 1,200 stations. And the large amplitude was observed wide area, and the duration was very long. PGA was large, but the PGV was relatively small. And because the input motion was amplified only high frequency for the station where the PGA was large. And the damage ratio directly related to the ground motion was low. And the source model is complex and maybe it's frequency dependent. Thank you.
Do we have any questions on this amazing data? Over here.
Was your intensity data determined from instrumental intensity or from observed damages?
No. And modified medical intensity was calculated using the method proposed by Dave Wald. So from PGA and PGV. For large intensity area, essentially the PGV is the key factor.
Okay, thank you very much. Do we have another one? Sir?
We usually collect the data automatically. When the earthquake occurred, the instrument in the observatory automatically collect from the station to the data management center. But for this earthquake, we have many troubles and Not all the data is automatically collected, and we manually collect after we solve the problem.
Okay, thank you. Good afternoon. Okay, our next talk is Source Model for Generating Strong Ground Motions During the 2011 Off the Pacific Coast of Tohoku Earthquake by Irikura and Kurahashi. And Professor Irikura will give the talk.
Thank you, Chairman. Topic I'm going to speak is Source Model for Generating Strong Ground Motion During the 2011 Off the Pacific Coast of Tohoku Earthquake. First of all, I would like to introduce the slip and moment rate distribution imparted from the long period ground motion. This is the strong ground motion data set and FNET data set. And the, using the long period, 20 second to 200 second. And the second, I would like to speak the strong motion generation area for from the short period strong ground motion. And it, but the for the long period motion, I just summarized. This is basically the, by Yoshida et al. And the, they present this result in a poster session. And this is a record section of long period, 20 and 200 second. And this is just the result, the total sleep and peak moment rate. So the peak total sleep already introduced by Aoi-san. And, I would like to add this, the peak moment rate. So the importance is the peak, if we put the peak moment rate, the, not only the trench area, but also the, we have some moment, large peak, large moment rate the cross to the inland. So this is just a refer, to refer the, by Yokota and, using the variety of data set, strong motion, the right, left strong motion and right side tsunami. So this is probably the, depending on the period range, and the strong motion is the large sweep closer to inland, and tsunami data the show the large sweep in trench the offshore. So probably this is some kind of dependence of period. So. This is a short period ground motion. You can see the several web packets. So using such a web packet, get the, like a strong motion generation area, the location of strong motion generation area. But there are two, several. We pick up the five, but this is just we pick up five. So five is not enough, might be not enough. But the importance is that there are two significant web packet, the first one and second one. So this is the most important where this web packet coming from. So using the back propagation method, that we determine the starting point of such a web packet origin. And we pick up the five origins that we call the SMAG. This is strong motion generation area, 1 to 5. So after that, we also pick up the web packet and determine the arrival direction. And the first web packet cross to the epicenter, and this is just one. This is not the point, but the converge this point. And second web packet, it's not the one point. Unfortunately, we didn't get the one point. There are at least two, but probably the second web packet is not the one origin, might one origin. We adopt one of the origin, and this is the we pick up the five strong motion generation area. This strong motion generation area determine the comparison between the simulation and the observation. So this is a comparison, this simulation and the observed. And the observed is the black line, and simulation is red. So this is Miyagi station, and this is Iwate and Miyagi. So the south region, this is Fukushima and Ibaraki. Using the five strong motion generation area, we can explain more or less the strong motion, the waveform. And this is just a comparison, the long period inversion result for peak moment ratio. This is background, and also we put our strong motion generation area. So probably the peak moment rate closer to the inland much where the strong motion generation area. So now I switch the different topic. This is a comparison, the data with the attenuation relationship, PG and PGB. Already Aoi-san explained the PGB is something follow the magnitude 8 or attribute larger, magnitude 8, less than magnitude 9, moment magnitude 9. But if we see the PGA, the source, near the source area, we have very large acceleration motion. So maybe this is important. This is one of the typical feature of this earthquake. So this is, you can see, this is a PGA, and the empirical relation is from C and Midorikawa. And you can see this, the very extremely the large acceleration. And we put this where such a high acceleration, the extremely high acceleration coming from, but not the same place, the same area they distributed. So if we put such an extremely large acceleration station on the surface geology, the most of the stations are in coronary deposit. So probably the such a extremely large the high acceleration caused to the side effect. So we picked up the such a high acceleration stations and more than 1,000 girls. And you can see the clearly seismic mobility. So probably this the seismic mobility means nonlinear the amplification. So this is one explanation for that Tsukidate station, and this is the H over B ratio for main shock have like a 0.3 second peak, but the small earthquake have like 0.1 or 2 seconds. So this means the during the main shock, this site have clearly nonlinear amplification, getting the S wave reduction. So another typical feature of this earthquake, this is we have very large acceleration, but following the attenuation distance curve. Probably this is not the only side effect. Probably the cause to the some kind of the source effect. So yeah, if we pick up the high acceleration, looks the some propagated. Some propagation. So maybe the high acceleration is caused to the heterogeneity of slip on the strong motion generation area. Our model for strong motion generation area so far we put some uniform the stress drop, but probably this earthquake have some very heterogeneous stress drop. So using this kind of model, we call the super asperity. We put some high velocity, and using the conventional model, we cannot explain such a high acceleration propagation, but using such a heterogeneity of strong motion generation area, we can explain the such a high acceleration propagation. So this is summary. Main rupture of the Tohoku earthquake propagated in the strike direction and the deep direction, including the both in the deep area of the Miyagi Prefecture and the shallow area near the Japan Trench. From the forward modeling, the source model for simulating short period grand motion, such as acceleration, velocity, seismogram. There are five strong motion generation area over the source fault located west of the hypocenter and along the down deep edge of source fault. Attenuation distance relationship of PGB from this earthquake follow the empirical relationship of moment magnitude about 8, but those of PGA show very high value at some station near the source fault, although they're quickly decaying with distance. High acceleration motions were mainly caused by two different mechanisms. One is the large amplification due to the surface erosion with decreased S-wave velocities, nonlinear soil behavior. The other is high slip velocity inside slog motion generation area. Thank you very much.
We have time for a question or two.
Yeah, the, so far the, we use the uniform the slip on the strong motion generation area, but like Tokachi-Oki earthquake, the Kawase and Matsushima the found maybe we need such a high slip velocity or a high stress drop. So probably this is not only this earthquake, but also something the common feature of the like subduction zone earthquake.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Is there a question? Our next talk is strong ground motion generation during the 2011 Tohoku-Oki earthquake by Asano and Iwata, and Asano will give the talk.
Thank you, Professor Lee. I'm Kimiyuki Asano from the Disaster Prevention Research Institute of Kyoto University. Today I will talk on the how the strong ground motion along the Pacific coast generated during the 2011 Tohoku-Oki earthquake. So as the Dr. Aoi already introduced in his review presentation in this session, a lot of high quality strong ground motion record are obtained all over Japan. And this is one example of the observed record. This is the velocity waveform integrated from the original acceleration record at the KICKNET MYZH12 station, which is just west of the epicenter. And these three traces are the same record, but in the different frequency range. And bottom trace is the most widest frequency range. It is almost close to the original record. You can see long period large ground motion short period ground motion overlapped on the long period motion. And the middle one is ground motion velocity waveform filtered between the 0.015 to 0.1 hertz. And most of kinematic source inversion study using the strong motion data use this frequency band, and they successfully obtained a detailed slip image on the source fault. And the top trace is ground velocity filter higher than 0.1 hertz. This frequency range is very important. It's related to the most various kind of the seismic disaster. So in this presentation, we would like to construct a source model for strong ground motion in that frequency range, higher than the 0.1 hertz. And in this example, you can see the two wave packet, distinct wave packet can be observed. So we modeled the source patch to explain the each wave packet. And as a beginning, I would like to briefly introduce the concept of the strong motion generation area and the asperity by showing the past result for the past subduction zone event in northeastern Japan. The strong motion generation area is defined as a high slip velocity and the stress drop source patch defined by the Miyake et al. 2003, and this SMGA is related to the generation of the broadband strong ground motion. And the asperity in this study is defined as a large slip area by the sum, by the definition by Somerville et al. 1999. So the asperity is a large slip area with a heterogeneous slip model. And these two examples show the comparison of the strong motion generation area and the slip distribution. The strong motion generation area of the past Magnitude 7 class plate boundary earthquake is located inside the large slip area, and the size of the SMGA is a little bit smaller than the asperity. So the, in this study, we located and the strong motion generation area of this Tohoku earthquake and modeled the source, construct the source model. And then I will discuss on the spatial relationship of the strong ground motion generation area of the 2011 Tohoku earthquake and past plate boundary earthquakes in this region. So the, firstly, we have to locate, determine the location of the strong motion generation area. So this is a record section of the observed ground acceleration obtained by the KNET and KICKNET along the Pacific coast. And this record section are according to the, its, their station latitude. So you can see the first major wave packet generated from the around 38 degrees and propagate to the north and south, and the, this is just the west of the epicenter of the, this main shock. And 40 to 50 seconds later, another major wave packet generated very similarly to the, this first wave packet. And the other two wave packets generated from the south part of the source region, almost the degree latitude is 37 degree, and to, you can catch that two wave packet trace. So we pick up the onset of the, those wave packets S1 to S2, S3, and S4 from the original record at each station. And using the, and these travel time of the those wave packet, we determine the location of the rupture starting point and the rupture time of each SMGA 1, 2, 3, 4, and 4. And those are responsible for the generation of the S1, S2, and S3, and S4. And in this study, the each SMGA is assumed to be located on the plate interface previously determined, estimated by the Nakajima and Hasega 2006 and Nakajima 2008, because this Tohoku earthquake is a plate boundary earthquake. So, and in the travel time analysis, in order to collect the site collection factor, we use one small event before the main shock is used as a mass event. So the, this is the schematic image of our SMGA source model. So the source model composed of the four strong motion generation area. And in this study, we assume that each strong motion area to be the square shape to simplify the model as possible. And the left map shows the location of the strong motion generation area obtained by the travel time analysis in the previous slide. The first strong motion generation area is found to be the just west of the hypocenter, and it ruptured about 24 seconds after the origin time. And second one is the found in between the first one and the hypocenter. So that means the and rupture the 65 seconds after the origin time. So that means the rupture of this event went back to the shallow portion, as already the Professor Ide reported in his paper. And the third and fourth strong motion generation area is found near the coast of the south portion of the source fault. So the all the strong motion generation area are found in the deeper portion of the source fault. And right figure shows that just how the error of the strong location of the strong motion generation area is estimated in space. So you will agree that the location of the SMGA is well constrained by the observed data. And then we will model the strong motion source model for the strong motion simulation using the empirical green function method developed by the Irikura 1986. We can simulate the grand motion for the target event using this formulation according to the omega square source spectral scaling model. So sum up the empirical green function in space and in time to according to the omega square source scaling. So in order to accomplish this simulation, we need to get the scaling parameter N and C from the observed source spectral ratio for each SMGA. The N is a parameter for the ratio of the dimension of between the target and the small event. And C is a correcting factor for the stress drop. And then we estimate the best set of the model parameter lengths and width and rise time and rupture velocity, et cetera, to fit the observed acceleration and displacement record along the course by the grid search approach. So this is the final, our best SMGA source model. So we have two SMGA in the west of the epicenter and two south area. And the stress drop of the each SMGA is around 20 megapascal. It is a not surprising value for us, a value as a subduction zone event in this area. And important thing is that if we calculate the total seismic moment of four SMGA, it is 1.37 times 10^21 Newton meter. So it's just equivalent to the magnitude 8.0 events. So this feature and the rest of the moment release is only contributed to the more longer period ground motion and static deformation. So this feature is consistent with observed PZA and PZB attenuation relationship. It already reported by Dr. Aoi in this session. So we showed the waveform fitting for the every station from north to south, and black one is observed waveform and red one the simulation. And in the and from the left column, the acceleration, velocity, and the displacement in the frequency range 0.1 to 10 hertz. And in the northern part, you can see the two well packet from the first and second strong motion generation area are well reproduced. And also in the Fukushima Oki region, these observed ground motion looks very complex. And all of the four strong motion generation area contributed to the ground motion in this area. And in the in Ibaraki Oki region, the southmost part of the source region, the third and fourth SMGA is dominant in the ground motion. And this is also the east-west component. The previous one is a north-south component. And this slide shows the comparison of the observed and the synthetic acceleration spectra. So you can see the synthetic acceleration Fourier spectra reproduced the observed one very well in the target frequency range. So our SMGA source model is explain the characteristics of the observed ground motion in Northeast Japan. So And we just compared our SMZA and the previous sleep inversion result using strong motion data. The middle one is the sleep distribution by the Suzuki and others. They are using the strong ground motion record longer than the period of 8 seconds. And right one is a unified source model by Professor Koketsu and others. It's Professor Koketsu presented in the yesterday afternoon. And the strong motion generation area obtained in this study could not be found, apparently could not be found in the sleep distribution because those source inversion studies use more longer wavelengths data, so the such kind of small distinct patch cannot be resolved well in this scheme. And this is this figure shows my main conclusion of this presentation. We compared our strong motion generation area of the 2011 Tohoku Oki earthquake with the past Miyagi-Oki event in 1930, 1978, and 2005. The left map shows the contour map comparison with the contour map of the sleep and of the 97 magnitude 7.4 and 2005 event. The 2005 event and the 1978 event overlapped each other, but this strong motion, this year's strong motion generation year is not over, not related to the 97, 8 and 2005 events. So these SMZA are surrounded by the source area of the 1978 and 1981 and 2003 and 2005 events. And if we compared our source SMZA with the source area of the 1930s Miyagi-Oki sequence, the first SMGA is corresponding to the 1936 M7.4 event, and the second one is overlapped with the aftershock area determined by the Professor Umino for the 1933 event. So we can conclude that this strong motion generation area is a reactivation of the 1930s events. And also the, for the Fukushima-Oki region, the SMGA is inside the location, source area of the 1938 Fukushima-Oki event. So this is the summary of our presentation. We modeled the source model composed of four strong motion generation area to simulate the broadband strong ground motion. And in terms of strong motion, the SMGAs may not be well resolved with conventional kinematic source inversion using low frequency seismic wave, and the geodetic data because the low frequency wave are dominated by the extremely large slip close to the Japan Trench. And the strong motion generation 1 and 2 can be considered as a reactivation of the 1936 and 1933 Miyagi-Oki events. And SMGA 3 can be considered as a reactivation of the 1938 Fukushima-Oki events. So the, in the 1930s, those events occurred separately. But in this time, those aspected ruptures almost simultaneously within two or three minutes. So the 2011 Tohoku-Oki earthquake is not only a tsunami-genic event with huge co-seismic sleep near the trench, but also a complex event rupturing the pre-existing asperity feature ruptured as a historical event. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. I think we need to move on to keep on our schedule. The next talk is a long dip variation of teleseismic short period radiation from the 11 March 2011 Tohoku earthquake by Koper and others, and Keith Koper will give the talk.
Okay, thank you very much. Before I get started, I'll just acknowledge my co-authors, Alex Hutko and Thorne Lay, and I'll just point out that we also worked closely with Hiro Kanamori and Chuck Amon. And primarily what I want to present today is sort of the short period radiation as observed teleseismically from the Japan earthquake. and it's basically the back projection technique. And what you can see is that across North America, the P waves were incredibly coherent. We did a multi-channel cross-correlation analysis, and what you can see is that there's something like 400 of the seismometers that are with a mean cross-correlation coefficient above 0.85. And if you just visually look at the seismograms, and these are unfiltered velocity seismograms, you can see that they're exceptionally similar, and that the coherence actually maintains up to about 2 hertz across the whole continent. And so here's one of our earlier results. And so this is a back projection of the data from North America, and it's centered in a pass band around 1 hertz. You can see that the energy drifts down dip a little bit in the beginning. There is some northward rupture. There's quite a big pulse there at 80 seconds. And then you can see later on in the rupture that things move to the south. And the short period energy continues on maybe for 2.5 minutes or maybe up to 3 minutes. And one thing I'd like to point out is that we did this analysis with the NEIC hypocenter, which is further to the west than the updated hypocenters. And so this whole pattern will translate to the east if, for instance, we use the epicenter from Rishengqu or Dapeng Zhao or even the JMA epicenter. Just as impressive were the P waves here in Eurasia, and we found almost 300 again with this multi-channel cross-correlation analysis that are just incredibly similar. And in this case, you know, these stations aren't necessarily uniform sensors and uniform installation like the TA is in North America, but yet you still had this very high coherence of the data up above 1 hertz, not quite to the same frequency as in North America, but still pretty impressive. There we go. And here's our movie for the European data. And of course, there's differences. It's not exactly the same as our animation from the North American case. And that's because we're looking in a different direction. There's different sorts of interference. And when you do back projection, you essentially, or at least we did, you ignore the effect of the green function. But nevertheless, you can see a lot of similarity where you move down dip. There was early northward rupture, and then later to the south, you saw more energy released. And again, we have about the same amount of time up here on the top over which the energy was released. So in our opinion, these are pretty consistent, and getting them from completely different directions and completely different networks. So we published this early on in Earth Planet Space, and the bottom two frames here just show a time integrated version of our animations. And the main point is that this energy that's around 1 hertz, this short period energy, is all to the west and down dip of the epicenter. Whereas when we look at the finite fault models, these are two that were produced by my colleagues. You can see that the majority of the slip is either near the epicenter or maybe to the east. And I think we've seen a lot of talks yesterday and earlier today where not all of them, but a lot of the finite fault models are still holding up with major slip near the trench. And this isn't necessarily surprising that we'd have a difference between the back projection imaging and the slip models. And that's because when you back project velocity seismograms, essentially you're sensitive to slip rate or slip velocity or some derivative of the slip. And so we wouldn't expect it to necessarily be in exactly the same place. So what we did is we took synthetics from one of these slip models, and we processed the synthetics exactly how we processed the data. And so what you can see is that at 30 seconds, we have pretty good similarity. And when you get past about 60 seconds, for instance, in this panel at 80 seconds, you can see a big divergence. And so the point is, the point of this slide is that even though the short period energy resolved from the synthetics, it doesn't necessarily match the input slip model, but it's definitely still significantly different than the data. So our observation of the down dip short period energy cannot be explained necessarily solely because we're just looking at the at slip rate versus slip. And so this sort of summarizes our results. This is an overlay just of the time integrated beam power versus, again, one of these early slip models. And you can see the discrepancy there. And this was sort of the model we proposed. You can see some of the rupture areas from these earlier earthquakes. And this outer border here, this is the aftershock zone. And the yellow would be sort of the region of high stress drop or rough rupturing that really generates the short periods, whereas when we have this the big pink patch over there, that's more of the smoothly sliding slip release that's observed geodetically and in the long period seismics. And I think it's fair to say that our back projection results are very similar and consistent with the other groups that have worked on this project or worked on this earthquake. And so if you look at these two panels on the left, these are both frequency domain techniques. And again, you can see energy near the coast here. You can see significant energy here and here. These three on the right are time domain techniques. And again, this is all with teleseismic data. And you can see, for instance, the Wang and Mori is very similar to what we found. This one was constructed with European data. Some of these are just with North American data. And so the point is that there is this consistency. The differences in the details, but overall, we're all sort of finding this down dip short period energy source. So comparing the slip and the short period energy is a little bit like comparing apples and oranges. And so a second thing that we did is we wanted to look just within the back projection images themselves to see, could we identify some sort of frequency dependence in the rupture? And in our opinion, back projection is most viable between about 1 and 10 seconds. And when you get to the really high frequencies, you lose coherency. And when you're at the long periods or the short frequencies, you lose resolution. And so we looked at a series of narrow pass bands that together, when you add them up, they sort of cover this region where we feel that back projection is most effective. And this was just recently published in GRL. And instead of showing the movies, what I'm showing you is sort of just the locations of the maximum of the beam power, energy, so every 4 seconds. And so the color just indicates the time into the rupture. And what you can see is on the top two panels that centered at 8 seconds and 4 seconds, a lot of the energy is relatively close to the epicenter. And in this case, we're using the epicenter from Rishangshu. And if you go to the higher frequencies, or in other words, the longer periods, centered at 2 seconds, 1 second, half a second, you can see that all these pulses then move down dip. And it doesn't seem to be gradual. It seems to be more of an abrupt change. And if we broaden out the frequency bands a little bit, so if you have a wider frequency band, you have better resolution and time. So you can compare the top, which is sort of our short period result, 0.7 to 3, versus our, I guess I wouldn't call it long period, but mid period or longer period, 3 to 11 seconds, you see the energy is over here. And so there's a clear discrepancy. And if you look at the time integrated beam power, the shorter period energy, it's sort of centroid, if you will, is about 50 kilometers to the west of the red, the longer period one. We did do several robustness tests to look at this, and you know, it's kind of a subtle observation. And so one of the things we did was we took a series of aftershocks. So these are all aftershocks that occurred, I think, within the first 6 hours of the main event. And we did similar back projections for these guys, and we just did it in two period bands. And so we did one centered at half a second and one centered at 4 seconds. And for instance, if you look at this event up here, which is B up at the top, you can see that there's not really a big difference between the short period and the long period you know, locations. And for instance, if you look at I down here, and just some of the other aftershocks, there's no systematic difference in the short period versus the long period centroid. However, when you look at the main shock, right here, we sort of retain this big offset. And so the point of this, or what we think this is sort of telling us, is that the apparent frequency dependence that we observe, so this sort of thing, is not being caused by some sort of imperfection in the back projection, some sort of unmodeled structural effect, some sort of green function interference thing, that it's actually a property of the earthquake rupture. Okay, and so one of the, to sort of summarize what we've observed so far, is, you know, this disconnect, and this was mentioned in the previous talks on the local data, the strong ground motion, that when you go deeper, you know you do have the shorter period energy, and these are just figures I used in a press conference on Tuesday with the orchestra, just to make the analogy that the energy release from this earthquake is segregated by pitch or by frequency, just like in the orchestra you have the tubas and the basses in one spot, and maybe you have the clarinets and the flutes in another. And it's not a perfect analogy, but another way to think about it is that, you know, there is short and long period energy that's being radiated from along the entire fault zone, but it's the spectrum that changes. And so our interpretation is that we feel that the spectrum is bluer as you go deeper and is more red as you're closer to the trench. And as we did this, we realized a key question was, what about the local strong motion data? So all these observations are based on teleseismic processing. And I was going to show you guys, this is the last slide, just a couple of things that I've noticed in the literature of folks that have taken the strong motion data and just done some simple travel time calculations. And this sort of shows that the teleseismic observations do seem to be consistent with the arrival of these high frequency pulses that are observed on this wonderful, you know, strong ground motion network in Japan. And this was part of a back projection paper in GRL, and this was an empirical Green's function model in I believe it was either in Science or Nature. And anyway, if I would have known about this, some of the work that was shown earlier today, I would have liked to include those figures. So I think it's exciting from the previous 2 to 3 talks that we're seeing this convergence of the teleseismic observations with the local data, that there really is some depth dependence or some along dip segmentation of this megathrust rupture, which could be due to changes in fluid content, changes in the material properties across the fault, and so on. And so we need to work on that interpretation and understand what it might be. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Short questions? Okay.
Yeah. Sure. So the question is, there must be something other than slip that leads to the ground motion, that you can't explain all the ground motion just with slip. And I don't know for sure, but I think there's some of this, you know, high stress drop patches. There's more maybe the stopping of the rupture, so the change in rate of the rupture, things like that can generate the high frequencies. And I think my colleagues who spoke earlier, who are experts on the strong ground motion, you know, they've developed their own models, and they also sort of have this idea that to explain the observations, you do need something other than the slip.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Okay, let's move on to the next topic and the next presentation. The title is The Great 2011 Tohoku Oki Earthquake probed the broad spectrum of earthquake behavior at the bottom of the seismogenic zone by Ampere and others, but presented by Meng.
Okay. Have the laser pointer.
Yes.
Okay. Hello, everyone. My name is Linsen Meng. So I'm speaking on behalf of my advisor, Pablo Ampuero, who stayed at home with his newly born son. So Dr. Kober just gave a very nice talk on the back projection observations of the Tohoku Oki earthquake. So we would like to further put these observations in the broader context of earthquake rupture dynamics, and hopefully we can give some implications on subduction tectonics. Okay, so here is the overview of the talk. So the most important observation of this earthquake is that we see the frequency-dependent rupture characteristics. That is, the high-frequency slip is deep, and the low-frequency slip is shallow. And another important observation is that we see when the rupture goes through the deeper portion of the megathrust, we see both very slow rupture speed, and yet it still radiates high frequencies. And these observations are consistent with interpretation that the rupture goes through a very heterogeneous transition zones made of brittle asperities embedded in a ductile background. And we further confirmed these hypotheses with numerical simulations and other geological studies. Okay, so this is similar to the previous talk. So there are many different techniques that can be used to study the co-seismic rupture process of the earthquake. Here we use the back projections. What is different of this study from other studies is that we use a high-resolution array processing technique that's called Monte Tabor Music. It featured with higher resolution than the standard beamforming techniques, and we also use the data filtered at 1 Hz from both the U.S. array and the European array. So the movie shown in the middle of the slides is the music pseudo spectrums. So basically, the warm colors of these images indicating the locations of high frequency radiations, which is normally interpreted as rupture front. Okay, so if we compare the high frequency radiators, shown as these brownish symbols, with the static slip models, shown as these blue. These yellow and green contours, most striking features is that the high frequencies is deep and the low frequency is shallow. So this is presented by a lot of other studies. So one thing I would like to comment is that this phenomenon has been seen in previous earthquakes, but not as clear or systematic in this earthquake. And also it has very important implications on strong motion predictions. So usually when people model the strong motions, they just assume the high frequency and low frequency are co-located. In other words, the high frequency is proportional to the static slip, but it may not be the case, and at least for these megathrust earthquakes. Okay, so one of the most frequent questions I got from people is that how robust are these back projection images? What is the uncertainty associated with the analysis? How is the 3D structures affect your result? So to address these concerns, we conduct a synthetic test. So we put two kinds of complications. One is on the wave propagation side. So we put 3D structures near the source regions. So this one has a slab and other structures. And then to balance the affordable computation and complexity, we connect the wave field using Ray series to the receivers. And then, so this is for the wave propagation side. The other side is the source. We use the kinematic source models from source inversions and use that as the input of our synthetic. So the figure on the right is showing the comparisons. The background color is showing the square of the sleep rate filtered at around 1 hertz, which is the power at 1 hertz of the input model. And the white dots is what we recover from the back projections. I think the spatial patterns is reasonably reproduced, but the absolute amplitude are less well resolved because of the interference issues and the incoherence of the waveforms. So besides the spatial complementary of the high and low frequency sleep, the spatial and temporal evolution of the rupture itself is also very interesting. Here I'm plotting the location of the high frequency radiators as a function of this epicentral distance and time, color-coded by azimuths. So according to the rupture speed change, we can divide it into several different stages. So initially, the high frequency just stalled around the hypocenter for a few seconds, then it's propagated at normal speed down dip. Then in the third stage, which is the most important stage, we characterize it as a slow rupture phase. We see very wide spreading of the azimuth and epicentral distance. So, and if you fit a slope of the rupture speed, it's very slow, less than 1 second, 1 kilometers per second. So the interpretation is that at this stage, this rupture really reaches a circular front, and you have the high frequencies surrounding this circular front, and the rupture speed is very slow. And after this stage, the rupture just propagates to both north and south at rapid speed. Okay, so this spatial complementary is observed by many different studies. And then people must be wondering, what is the physics behind this? Why do we have this kind of phenomena? From the result of classic fracture mechanics, we know that the high frequencies is the most efficiently generated by the abrupt rupture speed change induced by stress concentrations or the contrast of fracture energies. So if in the down-tip portion we have so much high frequency radiations, it must mean that this region is very heterogeneous. And also, we know that at this portion, the rupture speed is very slow. That means like the overall material properties here must be very ductile, so that you have slow rupture speed. So if you combine these two clues, that we can get a picture like this. So in the root of the seismogenic zones, we have the background as ductile materials, but we have a lot of brittle asperities, so that we can have both a slow rupture speed and high frequency radiations. Okay, so we, Yihe Huang has run some dynamic simulations to illustrate this conceptual model. To keep things simple, here we just use a 2D planar fault dipping 14 degrees embedded in the elastic half space. So we use a sleep weakening friction. So what we want to actually reproduce is what happened in the down deep portion. So we put a few asperities with high stress and small fracture energies. And these asperities are surrounded by the regions with low stress drop. So by doing this, we can actually reproduce here. We have the very slow rupture speed, it's 1 kilometer per second, and yet you still have the high frequency radiations. So this figure, this panel on the right, is showing the peak sleep rate filtered at two frequency band. One is the high frequency, that's the green curve, that's period shorter than 2 seconds, and the other is a long period, that's a period longer than 10 seconds. So you can see that we can reproduce this observation for the green curve, the peak power is in the down dip portion, and for the low frequency, like the peak sleep is near the trench. Okay, so actually this heterogeneous view of the roots of the subduction zones is inspired by the current model explaining the episodic slow sleep and tremors. So in southwest Japan, like we have the tremors, is usually it appears as a swarm of low frequency earthquakes. And the model explaining it just assumed that there are brittle asperities at the down dip limit of seismogenic zone. And since the tremors is coupled with the aseismic slow sleep, so there must be a more stable fault material surrounding these brittle asperities. So this is very similar to the model that we have. And on the right is just inform people that there are 3D simulations actually can reproduce these low frequency earthquakes using these asperity models. Okay, so but in the northeast Japan, in the Tohoku regions, we don't really have tremors. However, we do have a lot of energetic repeating earthquakes. So this is a map of repeating earthquake sequence, and this is the interpolate aftershock of the Tohoku Oki earthquakes, and this one is my result about high frequency radiations co-seismically. So the model explaining the repeating earthquakes usually assume that these earthquakes are happening on isolated asperities that was steadily loaded by the surrounding creeping regions. And one key features of these maps is that you see a lot of concentrations of these repeating earthquakes in the down dip limit of the seismogenic zones. And in the same zones, we do observe these co-seismic high frequency radiations. So these are consistent observations. So what are these asperities concretely? So throughout the geological times, some of the materials was brought up from the subduction zone to the surface. This is a geological study in New Zealand. So people do observe there are fractal distribution of brittle intrusions embedded in more ductile materials. So the interpretation is that as the subduction progress and the shear strain accumulates, the bigger fragment is broken down into smaller ones. So at shallower depths, you have seismogenic patches, and in the deeper part, you have these little brittle asperities. So one of the questions people might ask is that the northern east Japan, Tohoku region, and the southwest Japan is similar in the sense that the tremors and the repeating earthquakes are happening at similar depths, and the accumulated sleep are also similar. Why do they behave differently? If you are assuming that these are all generated by these brittle asperities. So the reason is that in southwest Japan, because the age is younger, so here I'm showing a phase diagram of the subducting oceanic crust. So this is southwest Japan, and this is northeast Japan. So since the southwest Japan is younger, and the depths starting a dehydration process is much shallower than the northeast Japan. That means that at similar depths, there will be more water content in the southwest Japan. So these fluids would help you to stabilize the shallower part and introduce the tremor and slope and slow sleep activities in the down deep portion part. Okay, so here is my conclusion. The Tohoku Oki earthquake has very clear frequency dependent rupture characteristics. That is, the high frequency is deep and the low frequency is shallow. And the other important observation is that in the landward portion of the rupture was very slow, less than 1 kilometer per second, but it is still radiate high frequencies. And these observations lead to the interpretation that we do really have a very heterogeneous brittle to ductile transition zones made of brittle asperities embedded in the ductile background. Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions? Yes?
With long duration? What do you mean by long duration? The duration of the phase? Or? Oh, sorry. Can you explain what you mean by? So here, the rupture speed is actually derived from this figure. So at this stage, you can see that if you fit it, overall rupture speed is very slow. And we know that when the rupture propagates to a down dip limit, it cannot go much further. The speed is very slow at this stage. And I believe some of the source models do have this slow rupture stage.
Okay. Any other question? Okay.
Do you expect there will be tremor down dip under Miyagi, or do you just run out of fault? Because I don't think it's been observed. So I can see it being deeper than under Southwest Japan, but why don't we see it at all?
Interpretation that we have is, the interpretation that we have is that I think the thermal condition is different at these different part of the Northeast and Southwest Japan. And I think it can be attributed to the different content of fluids.
Thank you very much. Well, let's move on to the next talk presentation. The title is The Rupture Process of the March 2011 Tohoku Oki Earthquake from Back Projection of Local Strong Motion Records by Marklin and others, presented by Nielis Marklin.
Okay, as it was said, the title of the talk is Rupture Process of the March 2011 Tohoku Earthquake, and we are looking at back projection of local strong motion data. So in today's presentation, I want to use these local data and to demonstrate how we use displacement amplitude back projection to actually obtain locations of high frequency radiating sources, estimate fault slip and moment magnitude from these data, and image the rupture evolution. So the study region, you are well familiar with it right now. The Tohoku earthquake occurred offshore the eastern coast of Honshu, and it was recorded by a dense network of accelerometer stations from KICKNET and KNET, which are shown on the map as blue triangles. The right-hand figure shows a three-component seismogram of acceleration traces from station Miyagi 11, which is the closest one to the epicenter. And the bottommost trace on this figure shows the vertical component integrated twice to show a ground displacement. And what is very prominent seen on this is two strong sources named here S1 and S2 and marked by these red lines. If we look at the displacement record from all stations across Honshu, we see as a function of epicentral distance, we see the same two phases very coherently across almost the entire array. And the move-out curves correspond to a shear wave velocity of about 3.7 kilometers per second. And you see parallel phases to the ones marked with red lines, which have a similar move-out, so we have many sources radiating from a similar source region. So in this study, we analyze vertical component displacement records, and we study these records in different frequency bands, starting from 0.05 to 0.1 hertz, and with the highest frequency of 0.2 to 0.4. So first, a brief outline of the back projection method, which consists essentially of two steps. First, we divide the fault into a grid of subfaults, and for a given phase at a reference station, a Miyagi 11, and a given subfault, we compute relative arrival times at all stations and measure coherency in a time window. We repeat this process for all subfaults and assign the coherency to the respective subfaults locations. And finally, normalize the coherency distribution we get across the entire fault, such as the sum over all sources is 1, to obtain a source location probability map. In the second step, we do another back projection with the same computed travel times, but here we try to recover the correct amplitudes. We start from this displacement amplitude being proportional to the slip rate, and the proportionality factor consists of geometrical spreading, the shear wave velocity, and the radiation pattern with a large R, and the size of each subfault marked here with S. So we have displacement amplitude at a station proportional to the slip rate. So, and if we can assume that the RMS stack amplitude of our back projection, we can replace this with a displacement amplitude, we can relate back projection amplitudes to slip rate, and if we integrate over time to slip. So, in summary, the final image of a single phase is given by the product of the probability map and the correct amplitude. The total slip is a time integral over these images, and to obtain the rupture evolution, we can subtract travel times from each subfault to the reference station, the final image, and combine the sources radiating at the same time to a new image. So let's have a look at the real data. We are imaging, our imaging region is marked here by the red big box. This is our fault plane, and it's a dipping fault plane, which is shown in 3D view on the right-hand side figure. And we divide the fault plane into subfaults of 10 by 10 kilometers and use a constant velocity for imaging. So first, let me show location of high-frequency sources, and I will show the locations of the sources S1 and S2 marked earlier. So this would be an image of source S1 in the 20 seconds time window starting at the red line. And we see a strong source just south of the epicenter of the event. And if we go to the second source, S2, it covers a larger area and it appears closer to the trench. If we now integrate all these images over time, essentially sum all these images with the correct amplitudes that we recover slip rate and slip, we get the total slip distribution of the fault, which is shown here for the lowest frequency band. We have a very large slip region close to the trench, with up to 50 meters of slip, and similar figure images for the higher frequency band. For the highest one, we lose a bit of resolution, so we have a rather scattered distribution. The estimated moment from these slip maps reaches 8.8 to 8.9, so which is lower than the real value because we use only high frequencies. The rupture evolution is shown here as a set of time slices. And this can be clearly seen on the first row that the rupture stayed for about the first 1 minute, mostly in the northern part of the fault zone. And only after we had the rupture of the strong source S2, at about 75 seconds here, we have a linear rupture propagation towards the south. So this somehow suggests that we have some kind of lateral mechanical or structural barrier, and the rupture can only propagate to the south once this barrier can be overridden by source S2. So one explanation for such a barrier would be oceanic fracture zones, which are perpendicular to the trench. And these can be only overridden when we have a rupture close to the trench. But we are currently working on the interpretation of these data. And the other thing where we want to, what we want to go in more detail is study the possible role of seamounts and its relation to these high frequency sources. So in conclusion, what we can conclusions we can draw right now from this current analysis is back projection images high frequency sources, and we also get slip rate of the Tohoku Oki earthquake. The total slip we get is about 50 meters near the trench and the estimated moment magnitude of 8.9. During the first minute of the rupture is confined to the northern segment of the slab with two prominent sources, S1 and S2, and only after the large slip of the source S2, the rupture could grow and propagate across an oceanic fracture zone to the south. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Now, Tam, what questions? Yes?
The P waves on our data are relatively small, so actually we hope somehow from the analysis that they don't significantly influence the results. Surface waves we did not observe on these data, so all these the strong phases are linearly polarized, so we think it's mainly body waves what we are seeing here.
Yes?
Actually, not yet.
Yeah. Any other questions? Yes.
Some of the other authors have mentioned a third source in the strong motion data, or maybe a fourth or a fifth. And did you find any evidence in your work of more than two primary sub-events or sources?
Yeah, actually, we have, let's say, three. We have these two ones in the north, which I mostly showed, and then maybe I can go. Maybe if you look on this image, you have another source in the south, closer to the coastline, which is S3, which is shown in other strong motion and also some teleseismic data. I did not go into detail here on this one. I did not understand the question. We made some synthetic tests to estimate the resolution between if we can resolve actually these different sources, and also computed a synthetic seismogram for the complete rupture evolution, what we got from this data. And qualitatively, this complete rupture source, the synthetics from the complete rupture source looks very similar to the real data, which is shown here on the left-hand side. But this is only a qualitative comparison right now.
Okay, last.
The large frequency zone is not so different from the others. What is very different is the different frequency behavior and the size of the patches. What we get, we are actually working on the interpretation of this.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. No, thank you very much.
Okay,
let's move on to the next presentation. The title is Widespread Seismic Excitation Following the 2011 Magnitude 9.0 Tohoku Japan Earthquake and Its Implications for Seismic Hazards by Toda, Stein, and Lin, and presented by Shinji Toda.
Thank you. Okay, seismicity turned on across the Honshu, even in the Japan seaside, and so after Tohoku earthquake. So there are questions. What is the origin of such unprecedented huge aftershocks? And also, what do they mean for future seismic hazard? So in my talk, I will argue that static Coulomb stress transfer will is at least a viable explanation for these widespread aftershocks. So if so, I think that seismic hazard for Tokyo has now doubled. So let me first show you the seismicity after and before the Tohoku-Oki earthquake. So this simple comparison tells you the whole story, that we now have a huge increase of seismicity of entire Honshu, northern Honshu island, and across the island itself and to the Japan Sea. You can see that, let's see. You can see the dot line indicate margin of the source faults. And beyond the margin, edge of the source, we can clearly see the huge increase of small shocks, including moderate large shocks in the coastal region of Fukushima and Chiba region. And even we go farther from the edge of the source, about more than 300 kilometers, we can still see clear increase of a number of shocks after the Tohoku-Oki earthquake. And yes, it's now I'd like to show you the seismicity rate change using a smoothing functions. So now you clearly see the seismicity rate change we mapped. I want you to look at the scale. So if it's red, the it's more than 100 fold increase. If it's blue, it's become 100th. So you can see these are some blues in area, which could associate with the stress static stress shadow. But most of the area, well, especially some spotty areas suggest showed us the huge increase of seismicity after the Tohoku event. And you can also see the pink triangle are volcanoes, but we cannot see any positive associations with the such volcanoes with the high rate of seismicity after the Tohoku event. So I'd like to show you the time series of aftershocks for some regions. And this is the cumulative number of shocks as a function of time. And you can clearly see that huge increase immediately after the Tohoku event. And well, especially this one, probably the rate of after the event is more than 10,000 times increase than the previous one, before the main shock. So, but the question is just what kind of seismic source produced such huge increase of seismicity? So actually we have many thrust, active thrust faults in the Tohoku, and we have some strike strip for the west, and in Kyoto or Osaka area, we have a mixture of thrust and strike strip faults. And well, to evaluate the influence of this Tohoku event strip, we just calculate the Coulomb stress change onto these receiver faults. So this is what we expect. So we expect, well, of course, probably, huge stress decrease, significant stress decrease for inland thrust fault Tohoku, and some moderate increase for Coulomb stress for strike strip fault in central Honshu, And plate interfaces nearby the source region, including normal faults and outer right region, now largely stressed. So, but you see, this is the large contradiction that what we've seen in seismicity, because we were now here expecting a large quiescence after the main shock. Well, the answer is a change in mechanism, earthquake mechanism. Well, before Tohoku event, we have a majority of moderate or large shocks have thrust faulting mechanism like this, colored as green. And well, with some mixture of with the strike slip faults, and after the Tohoku event, you can see that most of the thrust sources are now shut down, and you can see the lots of normal faulting events, especially coastal region and continental shelf, and further inland to Akita or some areas here. So you can also see the strike slip faulting events here, and this is a little unusual if we just think the east-west compression. Well, it can be explained by, of course, east-west extension, core seismic extension after the Tohoku event. So, well, it's easy to explain these occurrence of normal faulting events using a Coulomb stress calculation like this. So you see now that most of the normal events are in the area that Coulomb stress has calculated to have risen. So, but this is not the sufficient condition that to explain the occurrence of these events. Well, because, you know, it's too small to have these earthquakes itself. And, well, now we introduce the method of regional stress and to seek the plane's maximum shear stress. So first, let me show you, this is the typical east-west compression of 100 bars. So under this condition, even we have a stress perturbance by the Tohoku event, we still see stress shadow. And then most of the, only the thrust event could occur in this case. But with low constraint, low regional stress, like as low as 5 bar, you can see that overall regions are now have increased the stress. And we could easily expect that rotated principal axis, and which maximize stress for the normal fault event here and then strike slip mechanism here. So now we can explain what we observed from the catalog. So which means that we probably either need the low regional stress field, very, very low regional stress field, or we probably need that stress or structural heterogeneity in some scale. Well, I personally believe the latter case, but I don't have time to explain such a complicated situation. Anyway, this is a big picture. So now I'd like to show you the two typical off-fault aftershock locations for Iwaki and Tokyo. So in Iwaki, as I show you in the previous slide, we have a huge swarm event here, and just immediately triggered the Tohoku main shock. And there are lots of earthquake greater than 5, and the maximum one is magnitude 7, which occurred a month after the main shock. And most of the shocks are located in the area of the southern edge of the granite body, and then which bounding the with the tertiary sediment. So we had actually the many normal fault structures which has which developed during the Miocene period. So now these faults are reactivated, reawakened by the Tohoku event. So the maximum earthquake just show us the very clear surface ruptures as long as 30 kilometers in total. And you can see these are two traces. So from the interviews and geological survey, these two ruptures occur simultaneously. And you can also see the beautiful fringes made by my colleagues Fukushima, the name Fukushima. And well, actually, the Fukushima Daiichi nuclear plant is here. It's 40 kilometers north from the swarm area. And if we go to the field, we can see this fourth scarf. So now the Japanese golfer had another obstacle. This is a golf course, and this is a fresh fourth scarf that's made by the normal faulting. So this is the evidence of unusual mechanism at the surface after the Tohoku event. So what about the Tokyo area? So I don't need to explain the detail, but you can clearly see the difference of the seismicity after magnitude 9 event. So now we have lots of shocks after the event. And then you can also look at the size of the circle, which suggests the size of magnitude. And we now have more larger shocks beneath Tokyo. Even the Tokyo is, this area is a little far from the edge of the source. And well, these shocks are probably due to the plate structure we proposed in 2008. Fragment of Pacific plate is now wedged by the subducting Pacific plate and then Philippine sea plate, and making friction between these plates. And well, as you can see, that these shocks are a little deeper than the other shocks. And well, actually, we calculate the Coulomb stress changes for these earthquake sources, and we get the result that most of the faults are now brought closer to failure by the Tohoku main shock. And this indicates stress change value for this one. So, which means that stress transfer can expand the occurrence of earthquakes, well, aftershocks after the Tohoku main shock. And let me show you the time sequence of the seismicity in these two areas. And then you can see this is the cumulative number of shocks as a function of time for these two areas. Both is close to the source. And even in Tokyo area, you can see the clear change of the slope, right, responding to the Tohoku event. Well, the JMA catalog is probably incomplete, but even we use the magnitude greater than 2, we can still see the clear increase. And you can also see the stem plots, which suggest the change of the size of the shocks. We now have a moderate size, or probably as large as magnitude 6 shocks in off Boso area. So, and also, one of the striking features we found from this plot is just the decay process is too slow comparing the other cases. So which in which that we infer that this could be associated with the post-seismic after-strip. Post-seismic sweep just now expanding to the south from the source region. So let me leave these ideas that at the first glance that we just had a huge increase of seismicity even inland Tohoku, which actually inconsistent with the Coulomb stress hypothesis. But with the closer inspection, we found that stress field now flipped. So that's the reason that post-seismic stress change stimulates secondary normal faults and secondary strike sweep faults. And that's the reason we have a huge increase of small shocks in some areas. And supported by such a stress transfer concept that since we are having a huge increase of seismic rate in Tokyo area, which means that now the seismic hazard for Tokyo probably has doubled or tripled. But don't hesitate to come to Tokyo. Thank you.
Thank you, Toda-san. Any questions? Yes?
Yeah, that is one explanation. Alternative is just probably we have a local heterogeneity. For example, calderas, volcanoes, there are many in Tohoku, which has some weak material, which has changed the sigma one direction, and maybe we have also lots of complicated geologic structures that built up during geologic time. And sometimes we have extensional tectonic stress, and so some of the faults are now reactivated by such an unusual stress field. Okay. Thank you.
Any other question? Yes?
What is the focal mechanism of the earthquakes in the Tokyo area?
Well, most of them are thrust faulting mechanisms, so which is the same with the one we had before. Yeah.
Okay, thank you, Toda-san. So this is the end of the oral sessions, but we have a poster session tomorrow, and we have another oral session, the geodesy session, at room 2006 from 4 p.m. So please join us again. Thank you for all the participants. Thank you.